as well, which is one of the first airports that we went. So without showing you some of the previous reports, you see a product map in terms of particular products. What we're trying to do is by step and by bundling together so it makes sense for customer proposition and communications. So this just happens to be the next step on that journey. So it means that weekly available on bus for regional stage coach meet up for their own particular operator weekly product or the solo also operator product. Other products are available by the payment elements.
But they don't get it on
to not all of them, because different products make sense to be sold in slightly different scenarios. So four weekly, for example, being a more expensive product will be on the website and not on bus because of the value of that ticket. So that by the value and by certain legislation around refunds, etc., we have to go through the website, which will gather customer details on how to monitor its usage and replace days if lost and that sort of thing. So that's all pipeline at the moment.
The other important thing that we've always tried to focus on is bulk as well, Tom, because the vast majority of tickets that most regular commuters are using tend to be weekly tickets. So we're trying to get as many kind of people as possible using smart ticketing and focus on those largely sort of bulk products rather than some of the kind of longer term things that are used by a lot less people. So it's just trying to break it down in a kind of bite-sized kind of way to make sure we actually sort of roll it out in the best possible practical way for passengers. Also got Natalie.
Thank you, Chair. In regards to page 50, the graph, I was trying to figure out the reason for the decline for the period 8th of July to the 5th of August. Couldn't seem to come up with any reason why. Have you all any idea why there was a decline from the graph in terms of trips?
So when we introduced the hot listing process, we tried to make it as easy as possible for our customers. So now he's referring to June and July. We started the way in June, it was about notifying our customers in advance of nobody's inconvenience. Our starting position was that these weren't fraudulent, usually actually just people who perhaps have two or three cards duplicated in error. So we wrote to all of the people who potentially have duplicate cards to make them aware of our arrangements. And then from early July, we started to actually change the way that the cards were read on board the buses themselves. And that's really where the change happened, because the bus drivers still allowed travel, but they prompted the people to change the cards in our travel centres. And that's why the biggest decline happened from early July, leading up that once we started to change the behaviour on the buses, really.
John.
Thanks, Chair. Yeah, I just want to commend the authors of the report for this and the colleagues who've been working on this. This is within my portfolio area. And I just want to remind colleagues as well that this is, it's a cliche, you know, but we talk about journeys. We're very much on a journey with this, and there's a long way to go with this. This isn't the end game at the moment. Just responding to Tom's point before, there's a lot of work still to be done on this, and we are still making progress with it. And it's just a big thank you from me for all the hard work that is going on to move this agenda forward, because it is crucial.
Any further questions or comments? If not, can I move the recommendation to paragraph 2 of the report, if that's agreed?
Agreed.
Super. Next one is the Mersey Tunnels update for September, and Gary Evans is going to present this one for us.
Thanks, Chair. Good afternoon, everybody. So the purpose of the report really is to supplement the report members have received daily, which includes patronage data, reliability and so on, to just provide a summary of our key activities at Mersey Tunnels and put ourselves in a position where we can answer a bit more detail around some of our key projects and some of the other activities we're undertaking in the tunnels on a day-to-day basis. So from section 3.2 onwards, we touch on what we would say are our two major projects and summarised earlier on in the quarterly performance reports. The first one, summarised in 3.2, is the rewiring of the Kingsway Tunnel. Its age, built in 1972, was triggered that rewire demand, and it's a significant piece of work. And to my members who wouldn't have been in the original approvals process for that work to commence, it was about taking a lot of what is the wiring infrastructure above road level deck to in what we refer to as the inverts underneath the road deck to make sure that future maintenance and accessibility around that wiring didn't result in the need to close the bores in effect. That work has progressed well, and at the time of drafting this report, the statement that we were on target for completion in December was correct. It's been delayed somewhat by discovery of asbestos containing materials underneath the road deck itself, which has complicated the project significantly. And since drafting this report, the contractor has indicated there's likely to be a slight delay from completion in December 2017. And we're working through that level of detail with the contractor. The cause of that is specifically around some of the cabling works and the complications. So to give an example around that, some of the cabling works are likely to need to go into the ventilation shafts, and we need to make sure that we can maintain ventilation in the tunnel and maintain traffic throughput at all times. So that work will be worked through, and clearly what we've stipulated as well to the contractor is we wouldn't want to see any closures during peak periods which will impact on our customers. So we'll still work through that programme, but just as an early heads up, it's likely to run beyond December, despite what it says in the report, but we will start to see some real progress ahead of December, very early into the new year. Our other major project, which is summarised in this report, is the toll system refresh, which is quite topical with the most recent press releases that the organisation has passed out to the media. In effect, again, to remind members, as the organisation, the combined authority, works through the details of the devolution agreement around tolling arrangements, the current toll system is approaching the end of its life. So there was a need to refresh that system quite urgently, not to get ourselves in a position where we had continued failure. The project is focused on the refresh rather than renewal. It won't involve major civil works, but what it will do is build on a range of customer feedback comments that we've received to try and enhance the customer's experience in the lane itself. So some practical developments in the lane will see improved, well, renewed ACM or automated cutting machine fronts, a slightly smaller basket area and a raised reject cutting slot, so the reject cutting slot is very visible, and LED messaging signs that will actually show live time the ability for customers to help themselves in the lane. So for example, if there is a rejected coin, it will show in an LED message in front. If there's been an error with the tag, it will explain on that screen why, and give general messaging around that. Work on those lanes has already commenced. We've got two lanes in Queensway that have been installed, and the method that again we're demonstrating in that project is to make sure we do it lane by lane, so it's absolutely right for the customer. That shows it's been the right approach because we have encountered a number of problems in lanes 1 and 2 in Queensway, and we're working through those problems now with the contractor before we give the green light for the full rollout programme across both tunnels. What our process will be, particularly in Kingsway where we can have the highest volume of traffic, we'll only release one lane at a time for those upgrade works to go ahead. So we'll have to be open with our customers that it will be a level of inconvenience, but it will be minimised as much as possible, and the whole works are programmed around minimising that inconvenience for our customers. Once we see all of those lanes upgraded, we will then move really to the enhancements that we expect from our toll system process, and that is an enhanced and much more functional website for our FastTag account holders, and secondly, the introduction of contactless card payments into the lane. Once we do that, we expect that in early 2018, subject to the programme resolving itself and being in a position to move forward. From 3.6 of this report, we go on, 3.5, we just may go back to the toll system. The other significant change based on customer feedback we're introducing is in our staff lanes. Current processes see a staff member take a note off a customer, pass them the full amount of that change, and then the customer drives forward and makes a payment into the toll basket. Moving forward, that process will change, and the staff member will take the payment as part of that transaction, and we expect that to significantly speed up and improve the customer's experience in lane two. From 3.6 of the report onwards, we summarise some of our other activities, not as major as what I've just summarised. So 3.6 summarises my earlier comments around the Mersey Gateway, interoperability arrangements. We are undertaking a review of all traffic management and signage arrangements at both tunnels to make sure we try to enhance the customer's experience and ensure the signage is fit for purpose and visible. Work is ongoing around our communication systems inside the tunnel, so a lot of people may well be aware of what we refer to as a leaky feeder, which is the technology we use to rebroadcast radio channels, to use for our radio comms for our staff inside the tunnel, and also rebroadcast mobile phone communications for our customers. So again, the team are reviewing and looking to enhance those facilities at minimal cost. And finally, we talk around other programmes. One completed, i.e. the renewal of the Chester Street Toll Plaza. The structure is complete, and finally, where is well advanced in planning and actual procurement for a revised lane control system. Happy to take any questions.
Any questions or comments? John?
Very quick one from me, Chair. It refers back to 3.5, actually, Gary. You mentioned about cash there and about the new system and so on. I'm trying to project forward 15, 20 years from now when we are likely to be a cashless society, let's be honest. And I'm just wondering what our future plans in terms of future-proofing this is for the organisation in terms of bringing in the sort of relevant technology that we're seeing, for example, on the Mersey Gateway. So if you comment on that, it would be helpful. Thank you.
Okay, so clearly, when we've said it's a total refresh, very much in mind that the organisation is going through and committing towards a review of long-term the evolution of things around tolls. So we're making the decision that we've done around contactless cards. What our expectations are is a large proportion of the current transactions received by cash will migrate to card. The extent of that is to be determined. What we can say through intelligence is, for example, at other toll crossings across the country, we see approximately 65% of card of payments made by a card. Now, if you consider the Mersey tunnels, somewhere in the region of 25 million transactions per year. Over 50% of those are on fast tag at the moment, and that we still see as the real way forward in terms of electronic means of payment and also the cheapest means of payment. So that means there's around 12 million cash transactions per annum. Our target really is to significantly reduce that by more than 50% by the introduction of cards. We expect that to happen over a period of time of a change in customers' behaviour, and in 2 years' time to make an informed decision moving forward on that basis. And we've been very open and clearly communicated to that staff on that basis as well. So current recruitment arrangements, for example, with toll staff, are all done around fixed term arrangements on that, allowing us that position in 2 years' time to take an evidence-based treatment as we need to.
Any further questions or comments? If not, if I can move the recommendation in paragraph 2 of the report, that's agreed.
Great.
On to the seventh item, which is the local journey strategy, and Mick's going to deliver a presentation about the strategy for us. Cycling and walking.
So why do we actually need this strategy? As you appreciate, over recent years, the way we get our funding from government has changed quite considerably. The integrated transport block would have normally funded all these types of measures, but unfortunately, that has now been reduced probably in the region of 50 to 60% of what it was. And what's happened is the money now made available from government is done through a bidding process. Now, the city region has been very successful in actually achieving funding through this process, and in that regard, I would like to pay give thanks to the LTP policy unit in Burnley Travel for the work they've done in doing that, because they helped the districts considerably to achieve what we have. What we have found in the bidding process is that the lack of a consistent strategy to cycling walking has hindered us on occasion. The DFT have said on more than one occasion that if we'd have had a strategy, it might well have helped us in our other bids that were unsuccessful. Also, as you appreciate, the combined authority now through the devolution agreement, we have to prove that we're working more effectively and more efficiently, and we have to do that by showing that we can work together better in partnership, that we can do things such as joining contracts and driving prices down in what we do. Your officers that sit on the Transport Advisory Group acknowledged in 2016 that there was a long-standing requirement, because of the reasons I've just outlined, for a strategic approach to smarter choices. These are basically those modes of travel that are more sustainable, more healthy, help us to solve problems of congestion and pollution and so on. But the funding process, through the funding process, we recognised that we all had challenges in terms of capacity, the level of skills that we had to deliver these bids and so on and so forth, and that we needed to respond to that. So again, this strategy hopefully will help us to do that by developing a more central coordinated approach to what we do. We also want to focus more on an integrated approach, so that cycling and walking are integrated into all the strategies I mentioned earlier. So why is there a need for change? So you see from those figures that two-thirds of all the journeys in the city region under 5 kilometres are made by car. I'm sure you agree, really, that that is not acceptable and that we need to do something about that. So as I said, walking and cycling needs to be integrated. We need to cut across the other combined authority themes, including planning, housing, employment and skills, and economic development and regeneration. We want to make sure that what we do supports better air quality, provides health benefits and improves the quality of life for our residents. We know that it can help support employment growth by providing reduced transport costs and improved access to opportunities by joining what we do together. At the moment, we have disjointed delivery arrangements. Whilst we do get the integrated transport block, what that tends to do is make individual districts deliver individual schemes without any real Liverpool City region-wide benefits. We do have one or two schemes through the STEP programme, for example, where we are working cross-boundary, but we need to improve on that form of delivery. We did commission an independent approach to data gathering so that we could get a more holistic approach to what we do, and to make sure that it wasn't going to be led particularly by one district or by Merseyside Travel itself. We found that that has worked really well. Tiger in support of what has happened. And in that regard, there have been a series of strategic level meetings with your representatives on time, as well as your officers who are responsible for actually delivering these schemes on the ground. There are clear links to our growth strategy, our Building for the Future growth strategy, and the action principles that we now set out in the local journey strategy are based on the principles of productivity, people, places. As you'll see from the very first page of the strategy, we've already got the Metro Mayor's endorsement to the strategy itself, which is really good news. It's the first step forward for us. In his manifesto, as you recall, he does give the pledge to deliver a strategy to make sustainable, healthy forms of transport safer and more attractive to all. He wants to focus on placemaking, so that he wants to make trips around the city centre, the town centre, and so on, easier, healthier, and more accessible for everybody. We want a shared vision, and this is important. thing for us all. He wants a shared vision where we work together, not in isolation. We do feel that if we work together, we can achieve more. And I think the investment member recognises that as well. In terms of how we're actually going to deliver what is set out in the strategy, a delivery model and implementation plan will be developed once you, as the Transport Committee and the Combined Authority, hopefully approve the strategy. We felt at this stage there's no point in actually producing a really detailed, costed implementation plan for the strategy itself is agreed. It will be a data-led approach to what we do. It will be a centralised commissioning approach, hopefully. Now, this may require some investment, some rethinking of the way we deliver things. Some members will be aware from the KRN presentation that I did outline that if we are to work together more effectively, we are going to have to rethink how we deliver things. This will involve bringing staff together from across the city region, working jointly on projects, or allowing one or more districts to work together as taking the lead on things. What we do will be outcome based, so it won't simply be a matter of providing, say, a 100 metre length of cycle lane that starts sort of nowhere and finishes nowhere. We often do get criticised for that, so we want to avoid that in the future. So it will be outcome based. We will be looking at the success of this in terms of how many more people use what we provide. Hopefully we'll work with the likes of the health authorities to see what their view is on what these increased cycling and walking levels are doing in terms of the impact on health budgets and so on. So that brings in all these other things that we need to do. The implementation plan, as I said earlier, will be based on the principles set out in the growth strategy. We will do a gap analysis where we'll map out our current or planned activity and basically see whatever funding for sources are available that we can access and go for those, because essentially, we want to be as competitive as anybody. We will be looking for a project lead, and I'll come to that later on. There will be a strategic approach for bidding. We won't, again, be just doing that in isolation, as we feel our chances are going to be greater if we work together. The TAG and the Chief Executives have agreed a principle and model as to how we can deliver cycling and walking. We basically need to find a home for cycling and walking. It's always been on the fringes of what we do, and we need to find a home for it so people recognise where it sits. What we're proposing to you as members now is a delivery structure where we think how we feel we can do that. We're suggesting that it sits within the Directorate of Integrated Transport, within Virgin Travel. It provides a central point of reference so that we can interface with the DfT. As I said earlier, one of the weaknesses that the DfT think we've got is that there's no go-to person for cycling and walking. If we agree this model, there will be, and that is, will be a real positive in the eyes of DfT. And as you can see from those other service areas, it will provide an integrated interface so that we can have seamless journeys as opposed to separate things, not linked up at all. So our development approach, as I said earlier, we are going to have to rethink the way we do things. We're looking at possibly centralised revenue commission on behalf of TAG. Centralised coordination, I mean, we have that to a certain degree already in terms of the STEP and LSTF programmes. We're both looking at working on strategic capital scheme development. Now, essentially what that means is rather than districts doing things in isolation, we will be looking at bringing everything together for the benefit of the city region, as opposed to separate isolated schemes that perhaps, whilst they're good to some degree locally, too much in terms of the city region. It will strategically sit alongside the other modes that are already within the Integrated Transport Directorate. And what we suggest is that the project team be set up eventually that will be operating on part of the TAG. So there's an awful lot in that document. If you've got any questions, we do feel it's an important strategy that needs to be approved, and it will help us to move forward, particularly in terms of delivering cycling and walking across the city region. And in that regard, sir, I would ask the committee to approve the recommendation.
Thanks for that, mate. I've already got a show of hands from Gordon, and then Tom and Jed and others. Excellent.
Thank you very much. You know, I wouldn't miss this opportunity to mention the green credentials that have happened regarding to the air quality. So, first of all, I'd like to say, Mr. Mayor, it's good to see that he's taking a priority to moving that. And I think it's also about being smart city as well and how we connect all the different modes of transport is most important. And working the same with those communities absolutely connected. So, I hope when the air quality is looked at, what we do with that. Emissions from some of the PM10s really concerned about small particulates and the micro ones. I think we've just really got to agree with this city before we get the example of the city being chosen to transport the vehicles or to even days on the legislation that we've passed. So I welcome this time to the comments by the Commissioner. Thank you for the day.
Tom.
Thanks, Chair. I agree this is a very important strategy which identifies a very serious problem, namely that two-thirds of short journeys are made by cars. But I do think it doesn't go far enough to really address the problem in the strategy as it stands. I had a long list of things I wanted to see in the strategy. Many of them are addressed in the strategy, but by no means all of them. There were no real sort of strong targets in the strategy, but I presume that's all to come in the implementation plan that's going to follow. There's just a few questions I wanted to raise about the strategy. So the word economic growth pops up a lot. It's all about supporting economic growth within the region. What if there it becomes clear there's a contradiction between promoting economic growth and creating a sustainable transport network? What would win out in that situation? What is the port really trying to achieve? I wonder if there's also a contradiction between the stated aim of prioritising sustainable forms of transport and the Metro Mayor's stated aim of reducing the cost of commuting by cars by reducing tunnel fees. I like the idea of the last mile as a concept. I wonder if that could be applied to logistics as well, with edge of town areas where goods could be loaded into warehouses and then delivered in smaller vehicles to reduce the amount of HGVs coming into the city. One important omission, in my opinion, is there's nothing about speed reduction in the report, which is a big kind of barrier to cycling. This region's got quite alarming figures for people getting killed and seriously injured on their bikes and also for pedestrians, so speed reduction should be in there. Nothing about demand management and finding ways to reduce the number of vehicles. We need to reduce traffic to have the desired effect. The planning system comes into it, but I think something we need to embrace is the idea of car-free developments, building houses with no parking spaces whatsoever, so people choose other forms of transport. And I could go on about a number of other things that I think should be in the report, but basically, in short, I do think if it's going to have the desired effect, the strategy does need to be much bolder.
Thanks, Joe. Hopefully, managed to get all those points down, but you're quite right, the details of any schemes will come forward with the implementation. It's certainly not something that we're trying to avoid. It is something we are working on. We do have many a list of schemes that we'd like to progress, picking up on your other point in terms of prioritisation, we do have a transport pipeline, as you many members of the work, where we have an assurance framework, for example, that allows us to prioritise schemes. We'd hopefully do anything in terms of sustainable travel along the same basis so that we know that we're going to get best value for money, best bang for our buck type of thing. In terms of economic growth versus air quality, good point. Again, in terms of this particular strategy, the other thing is that we can say is that not only do we have this strategy, we'll hopefully have a cleaner strategy as well that will pick up on the council's point about cleaner water. Those two will work hand in glove. I don't think we will be sacrificing economic growth or air quality in this particular regard, one or the other. And I hope we can use the whole point about this. We want to make better. option. Actually, quite like it. We don't focus on that in this strategy, but we do have a road safety strategy that has been approved by the design authority. And if you care to go through that or contact us at we can explain to you what we do across the city we need in terms of screen reduction. Demand management, again, this strategy doesn't focus on that. It is something that we're all conscious of and that we need to start considering. It is a very contentious issue for anybody who has considered things such as congestion charging and so on. It is one of the most contentious things around. People will be aware of what happened in Manchester when that was even attempted. So it is a difficult thing to do, but we shouldn't shy away from that, and we do have to look at that. And Tag, as a wider group, is more than happy to take that on board. In terms of car-free developments, I did mention earlier on about the separacy air things. One of the things that we will do through this particular strategy is work with developers to hopefully come up with new developments, new housing developments, that encourage cycling and walking and serve to make access for public transport easier. One of my particular personal beliefs is that the type of development we approve these days simply doesn't even allow public transport access into them because of the layouts that we adopt. So I've got a personal belief about that. I've said two councillors from Holford probably recognise, but we do need to work with developers. We do need to get in what we call pre-application stage, that before the formal planning app comes in, and actually make sure that they can deliver what we want rather than what they want to reduce their costs. Have I missed anything?
I think so. I was also going to mention